Hello, people. Thanks for joining me. I'm Scott, and this is an Avarez Yairi DY74C. It has a big crack, a bulge, and a saddle that's just a little too close for comfort. Or should I say too low for comfort? He sure wouldn't mind if his saddle was a little taller, kind of like it used to be back in 1980. So these string windings that come up over the saddle, that's an indication that the bridge plate inside the guitar has a lot of damage on it, and some people like to double ball their strings to get this to travel back here behind, but I like to actually just repair the bridge plate. And I usually, actually I never, tear the bridge plate out. I just fix it the TJ Thompson way, because I think TJ knows what the hell he's doing, and I just do what he does. I'm like monkey see, monkey do. So we got the bridge coming up a little bit, so I think the first thing we'll do is take the bridge off and start repairing the bridge plate and getting rid of this bulge. We'll repair the crack while the bridge is off too. It's the whole back side is a little, it's got a little gap. There's nothing abnormal going on inside the guitar. These gigantic pinholes are the cause or the result of just normal wear and normal play. It's very common. You'll see me do this repair a couple times a month, probably. There she blows. You know, sometimes you dig in a little bit and you cry about it. But what I'll do is I'll get some hot hide glue, or maybe some fish glue, and just get it in here, clamp it down, and clean it up. And the other thing I like to do right after I take a bridge off is I take three pieces of masking tape, one down the center, and then two over top of it. It creates this little hump. And I clamp the bridge down with these quick grips. And let it cool. The bridge is still hot. Just clamp her down, let it cool. Keeps that arch on the bottom side. You want a little arch on the bottom of the bridge, but not this weird hump. It kind of pumps up right here. Kind of dips down a little in front too. But and that is the TJ Thompson belly reducer in action, flattening out the belly. Now, it doesn't typically flatten out the entire belly back here, but it flattens out this area real good. So the bridge is going to go back down nicely without having to take off any wood fibers off the bottom of that bridge.
Now, I use the shark skin to clean the crack.
If any of you guys have a better idea on how to get a crack ready for a spline, let me know, because this kind of fuzzed up the edges and I didn't like that. I'd rather use some kind of file, but there's nothing small enough. This has a kerf of about 10/1000ths of an inch and it was the smallest thing I had. If you try to put sandpaper on a razor blade, it wouldn't even fit in there. I even just tried folding over a piece of sandpaper and getting it in there and it wouldn't really go. But I've got this in cleats and repairing tops or soundboards. It's like a soundboard spruce material from Stuart McDonald.
and slice through it with a straight edge, and just keep making slices. Cut, cut, cut till it comes off. Then it's still way too thick. It's like 25/1000ths of an inch. So I gotta get some files over here and some. Get this Luthier's file, also a Stuart McDonald file. I'll try some of the sandpaper on one of these sanding sticks. 220, 320. Now I realize why my wrist and my hand hurts, because I was doing this for like 30 minutes and I'm experiencing a little tendonitis, guys. Gotta find a better way of doing this. A way that doesn't cause fatigue. Let me know what you say. Have you ever made a spline? How do you like to shave it down to so it's really paper thin on both ends?
So as you can see here, it's a little tall. It's flush here, but it's a little tall on either end. Ian Davlin taught me to come in with a razor blade on a little with a piece of tape wrapped around it and start making little slices. You don't want to do it all in one pass, you want to do it little by little. And you can take your time doing this, cutting through the spline. All right. Now I gotta get it back out, put the epoxy in, mix it up, put the epoxy in, stick it back in. Let's go over to the drawing board. I use the G-Flex Thickened 655, equal parts. It up here. I'm also going to add a little color with these Blend-All powders. The last one I did, I used wheat, and it was really good, but it was on a Koa top guitar. You use wheat. Just gonna use just about half the amount that I did in the wheat. I'll do a little white because this is spruce, and spruce is a lighter colored wood than koa, so I don't want it to get too dark. And then I'll go stick it in that hole over there. Yeah, stick it in that big old crack. He's gonna stick it in a crack, man. I think I might do a little more of the white. And let's go a little more white. All right. Also got a light going inside this guitar. So I have another crack over here that's not big enough for a spline. It's only big enough for maybe some hide glue. But I was thinking about using epoxy. I was thinking about using it as a test run to see if I got the right color and stuff. But anyways, this epoxy cleans up with naphtha if you get to it right away. Like I'm cleaning off my little putty knife with naphtha. I'm gonna wipe naphtha over this spot here. Overflow there.
Oop. I'm gonna get it on my hands.
All right.
Hold on. All right. This is I put some Johnson's paste wax on here. Now I'm going to clamp it up.
All right, and you can see I don't put a ton of pressure on these. I just barely get them so they're not, you know, wiggling too much. Like this one's still pretty loose, but I don't want to, you know, put a ton of pressure. You could squish one side down, and it could become unlevel. Actually, this clamp probably needs to come forward a little bit. I'm going to fix that and then let it sit overnight, I guess. Next, I take the wheat and just kind of rub it in. It fills in a lot of the little voids. Unfortunately, there were like two areas that had little voids. But it also, it almost makes it disappear right away because it's just a good stain for this top. Found this article in the Trade Secrets Volume 2, but you can see it still only works for like bigger cracks than the one I'm working on now. I mean, my rat tail file is 30 thousandths at the very least, and it's tapered. And he's talking about taking the taper off of it, grinding off some of the teeth on the sides. Still, the shark sandpaper stuff is 15 thousandths. This is still the thinnest for a spline this, or a crack this small. Excuse me. Anyways, it's a challenge when you're working with a small crack. So this little mixture that I just did was just golden brown, good old golden brown, and good old little bit of shellac. This isn't even the zinzer, this is just some flakes.
dissolved in denatured alcohol. See, when it dries, it looks more like that. Okay, now, as I come around the guitar, you'll notice it changes the way it looks. It changes because there's an uneven surface here right now. There's really no clear finish over top of the spline. So as we move over this way, you'll see it starts to look darker. But all in all, it might blend in. This track was done some time ago, and it was professionally done, and it's pretty dark. So, if anything, this doesn't look too dark. Might be too light. I don't know. It'll probably be light when you view it from this way, and then dark when you view it from the other way. Alrighty, now what I have here is some 1500 grit wet sandpaper. I took it out of the water and I dried it off a little bit. I'm gonna wet sand with naphtha, that cool, refreshing drink. I'm gonna use this little sanding block. And I'm actually gonna use the edge because I really just have this crack and this crack. Wipe on some fill and finish, ultra thin. Okay, I've got the exhaust fan running. I don't know if you can see the fan, but I've got some accelerator and some Gooboost. Accelerate her. I accelerate you. And I accelerate me. Then I take little pieces of the paper towel, a little bit of the fill and finish ultra thin, and I give her a wipe. Gonna take the accelerator towel, and I give her a wipe. Rinse, lather, and repeat. Till smooth. Accelerator. I'm trying to get the clear finish inside of this crack area to be proud of the surrounding surface, so I can go back over it and level sand it back 100% flush. Excuse me. Yeah, we need to get cracked area flush, because I was scraping with that razor blade and I was doing all sorts of stuff to dig it out. Now I gotta fill it back in and take a little more accelerator. And I'll accelerate her. I'll take you over this way so you can see what I was seeing. With that backlight, I can really see that stitch. It's like a big old scar right now. So hopefully once it's level, it'll start blending and disappearing. And if not, we'll just have a dark spot, a dark streak, and we'll cry about it. What happened now is I've sanded up to 1200 wet sand, and it's become... it came to the point where I sanded through to the bare wood right here. So I've got the fingernail brush again. I've got the golden brown shellac. I'm just gonna touch up that color. And then I'm going to switch to the wipe-on poly, because wipe-on poly is the thinnest of all the finishes that I can wipe on. This old catalyzed poly, or whatever the heck it is, varnish. Yeah, I'm going to go to the, and give it, you know, 15 minutes or whatever, and wipe it on. There is a slight little hump here from all those years of that crack being open. So we're not going to overcome that unlevelness that is present in the guitar soundboard. But I think the wipe-on poly adheres really well to this when areas have been scuffed up with this gray Scotch-Brite pad. So I'm going to go over the area. I'm not going to go over the touch-up that I just did too much there, but I'll go in between, and now we're ready to wipe it with some naphtha. The naphtha will pick up all the fine dust that I just created, and now we can wipe it with the poly. I take a paper towel and get some poly on the paper towel. And then wait 2 hours and do it again, or scuff it. I scuff it with the gray Scotch-Brite in between each coat. So I might do 8-9 coats, and then I'll wet sand with the 1500 through the 3000 Trizact, and then polishing compounds. Well, here it is. I did 7 coats yesterday, and there's a little skylight up here on the ceiling, so I wanted to kind of let you see that it's not 100% flat. I mean, crack that's been open that long, don't know, it's kind of bulged up, but it looks really like slick. It doesn't have any like scratch marks or anything, and the clear finish seems to, you know, visibly it's just like this kind of the same color and stuff. So I got me some simple green, and I got me Trizact 3000 grit. Just gonna do some elliptical figure eights. Ultra cut compound 105. Special pad. Ultra cut UC. I'll do some diagonal strokes this way. I'll go diagonal this way. I'll go this way. I'll get some more polish on here. I'll go with the green. Could get out the hand drill with the foam pads chucked in there and go through a whole bunch of different compounds if I was looking for a super duper automotive gloss. See any witness lines. So the next part of the repair is going to be to glue the bridge back on, and if you remember, I clamped this down and over that piece, those three pieces of tape, to give it that little bit of that belly I was looking to get,
And it is. There's like a little space until I come in and push down. It really indexes right in place with those little missing pieces of rosewood on either side. But there's a little gap, and then I push down, and it covers the gap. But the way I've been prepping these bridge footprints lately is with this saddle slotting file. It's for just for cleaning the bottoms of the saddle slot. Because this area, it came off, and it didn't come completely off, but I had to kind of stuff some glue in there. So I'm going to go over the whole footprint with this. Just real quick, and then I'll go over it with... Then I got to do a test, a dry fit with the clamps. So let's get the clamps going next. I just love when the X-brace lines up perfectly with the wing of the bridge over here on this, see on the top. So I get the clamp. And another thing, that white nylon piece on the foot has a little scoop in it, so it fits right over the brace. I think there is a TJ Thompson thing that goes over the brace and spreads out the pressure better. I don't know if it's actually good to set the foot right on the brace, but that's what they make those things for, so I've been doing it this way, and it's been coming out pretty good. This is what I'm talking about over here. The nylon foot has this scoop in it for the brace. And then on the top, right here, over the wing of the bridge, I cut this MDF. And it's concave on both sides. So it forces the pressure out towards the outer edge of the wings. And here's a look at the two shorter clamps. It's an adjustable foot to get beyond the bracing. The braces will be over here, the X brace. And then this goes right down on top of the bridge. I'm sure there's a call or something that gives more uniform pressure. But this just seems to work fine for me, so let's do her. And I don't plan on reefing down extremely hard on this anyways, like a red-headed step bridge or something, you know. I'll get it hand tight, and then I'll give it two or three turns with my soft touch pliers. And that is a good fit right there. Dang. That's a 3/1000ths of an inch feeler gauge. Little gap right there. But that'll get filled with glue. Well, I guess we're ready. And the glue is hot and ready. Let's get her. Next thing to do is take some 120 grit. I already ran this on here, but after the 120 grit, you take a little acetone and try to mop up some of those rosewood oils. It always comes off onto the paper towel quite oily. And I want to do that twice on this one. This one's pretty oily. Acetone. Then we'll warm it with a hairdryer. All right, there it is. I used the hot high glue. It really only took me 30 seconds or so to get all the clamps in place. And everything looks wonderful. A little squeeze out here and there. You can see all that hot hide glue that squeezed out on the back. Got the same thing around the front there. I got the guitar in the workstation, so I could swivel it around for you, but there's a light inside right now that's running out of length. Anyways. No worries. Yeah, you can see some of the squeeze out here. I think that's gelled up enough. Oh yeah, looks just like jelly. It's not real well lit back here in this corner either. Yeah, just get that jelly stuff up off there. For final cleanup, I like taking just a little paper towel and giving it a little wrap. I'll usually do like, I'll wrap it, then I'll fold it, then I'll come around, then I'll dip it in my hot water. I'll come in here and scrub. Well now, the bridge has been glued on. I repaired the bridge plate, reinstalled the LR Bags Lyric, I think it is. It's the one with the little microphone that goes right here. Strung it back up. It's only been a day and a half since I glued this bridge on, so I'm not going all the way up to E. It's tuned to E flat. And let's give it a listen. Really like these tuners. These are really good quality Alvarez tuners. And I don't know if I showed you the entire guitar, but it is a beauty. Thanks for sticking around. I appreciate you tuning in. Catch you later.